Today, we have a very special treat for all you leader bike loving yams. I want to discuss why the 1000cc class of motorcycles are stupid, but that's kind of why we love them. It's going to be a good one today, so pull up a chair, you sweet baby yams and squidlets, because Papa Yam is about to start. Grab a little snacky poo, a little tea, cozy up, grab a blanket, it's going to be a good video. Just kidding, I need to tell you about something first. It's only because I care about you. You've got only 2 more weeks to get entered for our Yamaha R3 and Suzuki SV650 giveaway. If you want to support the series on Patreon, we're only going to have 1 more episode until we reveal our next round of bikes on October 17th, and you're going to want to make sure you sign up for that. Trust me. If you sign up now, I'll give you double entries for that next episode, and you'll be able to help vote and choose our next bikes as well. As always, remember you can enter completely for free and do not have to pay to win. Just check our Patreon page to see about that. You can also pick up merch as a one-time purchase to get entered to win as well. If you use the code DOUBLE2019 at checkout, you'll get 10% off and double entries for your purchase. You're not going to want to miss out. Seriously. So click the links below, enter in whatever way makes sense for you, either through a free entry, a double merch entry using the code DOUBLE2019 at checkout and get 10% off and double entries, or signing up on Patreon to get automatically entered to win. Okay, enough jibber jabber. Let's look at 1000cc bikes and why they're really dumb, but that's why we love them. The ridiculousness. I want to take a minute and reflect on how ridiculous having a sport bike with 1000cc's can be. I mean, really, it's just like a Ferrari or a supercharged Corvette. Who needs that much power? Who needs a sport bike that has 200 or more horsepower going to the rear wheel, a quarter mile time under 10 seconds, a top speed of over 180 miles per hour? America. This is the one thing I love about America. No one really needs a leader bike to commute to work with, although I guess it's possible. Instead, we look at these street legal race bikes as something of a hobby and still try to get our knee-dragging street Rossi on anyways. It's part of the freedom that we have in the good old US of A. For those of you in Europe, this is what freedom feels like. Wait, you can't feel it because you're an A1 squid. For us in America, we can have the Turbo Hayabusa if we wanted to, and speaking of which, would you smash that subscribe button? If your Papa Yams hits 1 million subs, I'm getting a Turbo Busa. I promise you, it'll be amazing and scary at the same time. Maybe I'll rip a mega dank nooner for once, since all that power is gonna pull the front wheel off the ground and turn that bike into a unicycle from hell. A brief history of the leader bike. I wanted to start with a brief history of the leader bike phenomena. The modern day 1000cc supersport bike is rooted from a time in the late 1990s. In 1998, Suzuki halted production of their GSXR 1100 and Yamaha released its 1000cc sport bike, the R1. With a growing market for sport bikes, manufacturers tried to scramble and discover the secret formula for both racing and sales. Suzuki touted its GSXR 750, while Yamaha rolled on with its R1 model, Kawasaki had the ZX9R, and Honda had the CBR900RR. The big four in Japan was testing various engine and frame combinations to create the best bike possible. Suzuki didn't have a flagship bike until 2001 when it released the GSXR 1000. And this bike was no BS, and it was based on the 750 chassis and engine. With Suzuki rolling on a bike with 1000cc's to counter the R1, the leader bike war officially started. Yamaha introduced the CBR1000RR in 2004, and Kawasaki ended the 900cc bike and introduced the ZX10R in 2004, completing the big four's presence with super sport bikes with 1 liter of displacement. Over in Europe, the Ducati 999 was introduced in 2003, and the Aprilia RSV Mille hit the market in 2004. It's safe to say that in 2005, leader bikes were now a thing, and every company had one on the streets. The competition. As leader bikes became popular, so did their mods, power increases, and even presence on the racetracks. As manufacturers began to see what their bikes would do against the competition, they began to develop new technology for their motorcycles to win more races. When you consider why a company pushes its R&D team further, it's normally to become better at something. In order to win races, new developments were made with this bike over the years. As technology became more advanced in areas outside of motorcycling, it was the leader bikes that first started to use advanced technologies on the track. Frames were lightened, engines were completely redesigned, and new materials were used. The technology. Ever wonder where the Kawasaki 300 received its ABS brakes from? Leader bikes. With the need for the most advanced race equipment, the leader bike manufacturers pushed the bikes to the limits and began using as much tech as possible. Things like lap timers, digital displays, and quick shifters became normal. Jealous? We love and hate leader bikes because of the benefits they give the rest of us. Okay, nobody really hates leader bikes. Once a certain type of technology is developed and adopted, there is an adaption phase, and then the technology of the leader bike is assimilated by the rest of the industry. You can consider the leader bikes to be the test subjects for new technology, but some of it won't fully trickle down due to the costs. How do you get a leader bike to go wide open without popping a wheelie? How do you make a bike safe enough for the tracks, but also safe enough for the inexperienced rider on the streets? These are some of the problems that manufacturers face with leader bikes. Their answer? ABS brakes, wheelie control, traction control, quick shifters, and so much more. Manufacturers took hints from the aftermarket and began putting Showa or Olin suspensions, Brembo brakes, and even Yoshimura slip-ons directly from dealership floors. Bike manufacturers no longer had the responsibility of building the entire bike. Specific parts would come from recognized brand names who were a lot better than they were at building certain things. ECUs with built-in rider modes that change fuel maps, exhaust valves that alter back pressure, and other technologies were all developed in leader bikes and passed down to their smaller displacement siblings over time. Which leads us to the trickle effect. If you're riding on your 600cc bike and wonder where that shift light came from or even the gas light, it was probably on a leader bike first. Much like how only luxury cars had tire pressure monitor systems back in the early 2000s, no one really started to see them until it became law. Once luxury cars had them, every other car began to have them as well. That same principle applies to leader bikes. As the next generation is released with the TFT screen, LED headlights, and taillights, the little brother 600s and other displacements are anxiously awaiting their facelifts and the trickle down of technology. I mean, you only have to look at the beginner bike class to see how far it's come in the last 10 years. It might not be necessary to have a lap timer on your street-only 600, but the technology came from a leader bike. I guarantee it. We need leader bikes more than ever if we're going to have updated platforms for other displacements. It's always the leader bikes that pave the way forward with new concepts, new technologies, and new materials. As the leader bikes use the new technology, the price of it begins to decline, and suddenly it's financially possible for every Suzuki or Yamaha to have a TFT display as opposed to their standard backlit gauge displays. Hell, even the Duke 390 today is being sold with the TFT display. How crazy is that? That's a beginner bike. If you're waiting for the next generation update to a specific bike, look towards its leader bike counterpart if you have the requisite skills and experience. The leader bike's gonna get most of the updates first, and then when other models are ready, they'll receive much of the same as well. The need. We need leader bikes because they're used in MotoGP and other racing homologation categories where the ultimate tests of endurance are conducted. Any technology that can withstand such strenuous racing is going to be worth putting on every other motorcycle. Manufacturers came to very informed conclusions before deciding to install Brembo brakes on every bike coming through its assembly line or to add the features including in a new electronic display. Seems apparent that auto manufacturers are doing away with some of their outdated technology and are actually listening to what consumer wants. For leader bikes, the same applies. We want better factory suspension, better lighting, and hell, better bikes. The response? Well, guess what? We got better bikes. Street legal and track ready bikes are now a thing. In addition to leader bikes, it's the next evolution in motorcycling. Kawasaki has the H2, Suzuki has the GSXR 1000R, and Yamaha has the R1M, to name a few of the leader bikes designed specifically for street riding and track days at the same time. This kind of feeds into the larger trend over the last 30 years of motorcyclists becoming more and more specialized as well. What's even more insane is that there's now a market for track-only leader bikes, such as the HP4 Race from BMW, which is $78,000, and even the Kawasaki H2R, which is $55,000, and let's not forget the Panigale V4R either, even though it's not a track-only model, technically. Manufacturers also started to realize that there's a market for insanely high-spec homologation machines, but also a separate market for cheater motorcycles with more than 1,000 cc's of displacement. Think your Ducati V4S or your Aprilia RSV4 1100 and those sorts of things. I really think that's going to be the next benchmark for motorcycles as well. Most of the street-legal bikes are currently in production, with race-only bikes being made in limited runs. Still, the race bikes are usually sold out and others are put on waiting lists for the next year, if they're still making them. The conclusion. I think everyone gets one benefit one way or another from leader bikes. Whether it's something you ride or you want to ride someday, or even if you want to stay on your 600 or your 750, whatever it is, it's fine. Your motorcycle, no matter what it is, was probably influenced by the up-and-coming technology of a leader bike at one point or another during its development phase. Although no one can legally max out a leader bike on the street, they're still a heck of a lot of fun to ride, both on and off the track. For what they are the pioneers of the motorcycle industry, and they're a much needed class of bike that helps the rest of us. Thanks for watching today's video. Like I said before, 1 million subs and I'll get a Turbo Busa. Find that weird kid from high school that you never really talked to and have him subscribe to my channel. He won't regret it. Let me know in the comments what you personally think of leader bikes. Do you love them? Hate them? Want one? You probably want one, let's be honest. And don't forget to check out our motorcycle giveaway. Seriously, sign up before our new season begins on October 17th and you'll get double entries for those episodes we produced before that one. We've got that brand spanking new Yamaha R3 and Suzuki SV650. You're not going to want to miss out on these. Remember, sign up through Patreon and get double chances or merch using the link below and use the code DOUBLE2019 to get double entries to win. Thanks again for watching, tune in next time, and I'll see you later. Fact. When you use a jumble of symbols in place of a curse word, it's pretty obvious what you mean and how strongly you feel. But what you might not know is those symbols used in this particular way are called a grolix. This term was coined by the late cartoonist Mort Walker, creator of Beetle Bailey, although the use of grolixes in comics preceded him. Goodbye.